Hello, in this video, I'm going to take this Ikea air quality filter, throw in a D1 mini, dusting with a little ESP home, and get it into Home Assistant. Stay tuned for part 3 in this series, as I've updated the code to my Ikea air quality sensor tutorial, making the combined system smart. First of all, the filter itself, it's quite a big unit, and basically all it's got is 3 speeds. So you've got off, 1, 2, and 3. There's a little light there for the filter. So what we need to do is get rid of this, put that to one side, get rid of the filter. None of the scope. So everything we need is underneath this side, just 2 screws. Let's take that off. We'll unscrew those like so, and then that should just slide off there. So we'll keep the screws in there as well. And then what we've got here is a bolt. We've got the 24 volts coming in, and then we've got 4 wires that go out to this quite big fan in the middle there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this bolt off, and we'll just work on that. So what we'll do is rip the knob off, and then underneath there we've got a nut, so we'll just unscrew that. And then what I like to do with these things is get a screwdriver, and you can just spin it there like so. We'll take that off, grab the washer as well, and then on the board itself you've got 2 screws, so we'll take those out as well, and then the board will just slide out. Next we're going to unplug these, and then that way we can work on the board itself and we can get rid of all this hardware. So on the bottom of the board we've got some quite nice solder points. We've got 24 volts in and ground that comes in off of that connector there, and also we've got a clock signal that's used as a kind of PWM for the fan, so we're going to pulse that on there. And also coming back from the fan, we've got a pulse here so we can tell the speed, or in this case I'm going to use that to do a filter age, and you'll see how that works in a minute. What we need to do is connect a bunch of wires to this. So for this I'm going to use a red, a black, a green, a white, a yellow, and the blue, and I want at least 3/4 of the way across the board, plus another, we got there, 4 inches will do. So let's strip these off and get them tint. So we can move little twists. So as always, I am soldering most of the wire, but I'm leaving a little blob right at the end there. So I'm just going to put a little blob on each one of those at the base, and then we can just line them up with the blades and the cutters there and snip them all off. So let's get it soldered to the board. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put a blob of solder on each one of these pads. That one there called clock. Needs one as well. And that one at the top there that says FB. We'll put one there. So the wire's coming out to the right here. So first of all, 24 volts. Next I'm going to do the ground. Then I'm going to put a green wire on the clock. That CLK there. Now on that FG, I don't want the full signal coming out of that. So what I've done is I've cut a 10K resistor, and I've just bent the end round roughly 90 degrees and cut the leg off there. And I'm going to solder that onto that pin just there. And then I'm going to put the blue wire on the end of that one. There we go. I'm not going to worry about heatsink. There's nothing up here apart from ground, and it's not really going to touch anything. The way this works, we've got a pulse going into this clock signal here, but there's also a MOSFET, which controls the 24 volt power going to that fan connector. And in normal operation, this microcontroller turns that MOSFET on, which powers the fan. So when it's off, the fan doesn't get any power. There's actually a pair of them. There's this one here and that one there. So what we need to do is supply the gate to this transistor with a 3.3 volt signal that comes off our D1 mini. And to do that, I'm going to connect a wire to the top of R13 there. Now, if you're worried about getting a bit of solder on there, you can scrape this track off and connect your wire there. But I'm going to solder directly onto that. And for that, I'm going to use a white wire. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to clean my solder line, put a bit of solder on my iron there. I'm going to bend this into a dog leg, so that I can hold it above the board but still push down on that R13. And then just very gently, I'm just going to heat the wire up so the heat goes through the wire and melts the solder onto that R13. And then I'm just going to hold that down, a little bit of a peak there, so I'm just going to sort of tap that off just to make that a little bit neater. Right, so that's all the wires connected to the board. Next thing we need to do, because I've got 24 volts coming in here, obviously the D1 mini only runs on 5, I'm going to use one of these little things. This is a regulator. It will take up to 35 volts in and give 5 volts out, this particular one. It's a 5 volt one. You can get them in 3.3, 5 and 12. So let's attach some wires to that. Now I'm going to take the yellow and the black, which is our supply in, and leave it about an inch or so. I'm going to cut the yellow one down, and I'm going to split the black one in half. Just the insulation, and I'm going to twist that round, and let's pull the wire off of there. Now, I've already tinned the pins on this one, so we'll just do a little bit more there, just get a bit of a blob on there. So, working from left to right, we've got the input here. This is going to be our 24-volt input. We've got common ground, and then we've got the 5 volts out. So, with the yellow wire, I'm going to tin that there, and we'll put that on that first pin. the black wire. Let's pull this out a little bit more. I'm going to fold that in half. And I'm going to tin that wire. Nice bubble solder on there. And I'm going to put that in the middle on that middle pin there. So again, I'm heating up the solder on the wire so the heat goes through to the pin underneath. And then the red wire, make sure there's a nice blob of solder on the end there. And then that red wire will go on the last pin there. Like that. So now what we're going to do, we're going to connect all these wires to our D1 Mini. Now I'm using the V3 here, V2 will work just as well. I need 5 volts and ground tinned. So a nice lot of heat there on those two. And let's connect up our 0 volts. And in this one, I want the wires to come across. So I want the wire this side, first of all. And then we'll do the 5 volts coming off this regulator board. So just pull that through there. And I'm just going to pull that to get my length. So about that far. Cut that off. Tin that one as well. And that's going to go to the 5 volt pin. Again, make myself a little angle just so I can hold the wire above the board. But the actual exposed wire is low down. That's the supply in. Next, we'll connect up our control wires. Trying to keep everything reasonably neat. So let's go with the white wire first. And our white wire is going to go on D2. So about that length. There's a white wire on D2. Nice bubble solder on there. That's that one. And next one we're going to do the green. This one's going on D7, which is the other side here. So again, just pull in the wires, get himself a rough length. Cut that. We're going to do D7 and D6. So I'm just going to solder both of those. Just going to tin both of those up now. So that's D6 there. And D7. Again, turn it round. So green wire on D7. And then the blue wire on a D6. So again, I'm going to cut that. There it is. Most of the magic is done in the code. We've taken the 24 volts coming into the unit and off of this board through a regulator because it's 5 volts there. And then onto the 5 volts and ground of a D1 Mini. The MOSFET signal to energize the fan. We've got the pulse signal to govern the speed of the fan. And then coming back, we've got the blue wire there, which is a pulse coming back from the fan. And all that's going into the D1 Mini on there. Next thing we do, we'll tidy up and we'll get some code going. Now, inside Home Assistant, we're going to go to ESP Home. I'm going to make a new device, continue there. I'm going to call this one Studio Air Filter. It doesn't matter about what I choose here. I'm going to give you the code anyway. We're going to skip that. And there it is there. So we edit that. I'm going to delete all of this. Next, we're going to go to my GitHub page for this. We want the Air Filter ESP Home code. So we'll click on that link. Go up to here and do copy raw file. That will save it into the clipboard of my computer. And then back into ESP Home, we can just simply paste that in there. As always, all the code's done for you. You just need to change a couple of things. So first one being the device name. So we'll copy the YAML, put that in there. And then for the entity name and room, I'm just going to call this one Studio Filter. Everything else you can leave the same. It'll run perfectly well with the code that I've already written. But let's go through the code anyway. So first of all, before anything happens, Control S to save that. So I've mentioned the substitutions and the device name, so standard boilerplate for a D1 Mini. I'm also going to be saving some things to flash, which I'm going to need for power cycle and for resetting. So I'm using the restore from flash, true. And because I'm doing something with the filter, and you'll see what that is in a minute, but I'm using something I've called filter age. And normally on the IKEA, I think it's roughly every 6 months, the little light comes on the top of that box to tell you that the filter needs changing. Now I'm doing something different with this fan because I consider the fact that if you're running the fan at a slower speed, so like speed 1 all the time, then you won't need to change the filter that often. So I'm taking the speed of the fan into account with the filter age. But basically all this does is it take the filter age and restore the filter age back when it's powered up again. I've taken a load of stuff out of the logs so it doesn't keep firing. And the flash write interval here, I set that to 3 minutes. That's for the speed setting that you set the device to. Global value here, that's a variable, filter age. So I've given that an ID of filter age so I can reference that elsewhere in the code. It's an integer and I want to restore the value from flash. So restore value, yes. Next up is a binary sensor. And all this is doing, when the filter gets dirty, this binary sensor gets turned on, and you'll see that lower down in the code. This will come into Home Assistant as the name, which is Studio Filter. We don't need that, actually. So let's get rid of that. Yeah, we won't need that. I'll update the code. So this will be Studio Filter Dirty. Again, restore from flash. Let's take that out as well while we're here. Also in Home Assistant, from ESP Home, I'm gonna give you a reset button. Now, on the device itself, there is a button underneath that front cover that you press to reset the light when you change the filter. Well, obviously we're not using that light, we're not using that button, so we'll have a button in Home Assistant, which I'm gonna call reset button, and that'll come into Home Assistant as Studio Filter Reset. And all this is going to do, when you press it, on press, it's going to take the filter counter, which you'll see in a second, low down in the code, and reset it to zero. It's then going to wait 1 second. It's going to turn off the onboard LED on the D1 Mini. And then as soon as it's done that, it's going to do this function. Now, this is Global Preference Sync. And what that's doing is that's going to immediately save the value of filter counter, in this case, to flash. Now, normally you'd have to wait this 3 minutes, this preference is here. What I thought was, well, if you change the filter and then reset it and then unplug it within 3 minutes and move it somewhere else, then the write to flash is not going to be immediate. It's going to forget that you've pressed the button. So this little bit of code here, this lambda, immediately saves all the states to the flash. Now the speed of the fan, let's just take that out as well. Again, I'll change this in the code before you get a chance to download it. So the speed of the fan is governed by a slider. Now a slider in ESP Home is a number. The fan on the IKEA filter, if you remember that knob on the top is off, and then you've got 1, 2, and 3 speeds. Well, I've given you 6. So we've got 0, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 different speeds. So you've got a bit more gradient on the speed of the fan there, and it'll help with the noise, etc. So on this number, or this slider, it's going to look at every time the slider is moved. So every time an action has been made on this slider, whether it's automatic or you've manually adjusted it in the Home Assistant, it's going to look at that value, which comes in as X. So for the condition, I'm going to say if X, which is the value of this slider, is greater than or equal to 1, then we're going to do something. First thing we're going to do is turn on that MOSFET, which is going to give 24 volts to the fan. It's then going to write the fan motor ID with a level of 1. I'm using the servo component on this. As I say, it's not quite a PWM signal, so we can't really do PWM on that motor. It just takes pulses. So the servo in this instance is ideal. Also in this, then we're going to take the value, which again is the value of this slider, and multiply it by 50. I've done a lot of R&D on this, and 50 pulses per second gives you approximately speed 1, and 300 pulses, which is 6 times 50, in this instance is going to give you speed 6. So we've got all the other range in between in multiples of 50 from 1 through to 6. And then finally in this condition we've got an else, so if not, if the value is not greater than or equal to 1, i.e. 0, it's going to set the PWM frequency of the servo component back down to 0. So that will return a 0 to this output, which we'll see in a second. Next is the sensor for the filter. Again, let me just edit that. So for this, I'm using a pulse counter. Now, as I said, coming off this board on this blue wire here is a pulse per revolution of the fan. So I'm going to use a pulse counter, and I'm also using a total here, because what I want to do is I want to keep a running total of how many times that fan has been spinning, which is obviously a product of the speed, to work out how old the filter is. And that's going to be a unit of measurement of age. And I've called this one age. So this is going to be, again, with the substitutions, Studio Filter Age. And that comes into Home Assistant. I'm going to keep that in, actually. I was going to take it out because you really only need to see whether the light is on or off. But we'll give you the filter age so you can have a look at that. And pretty much all this is doing is making a filter age governed by the speed of the fan. Now, for the demo, I've got this set to 30. For 6 months, I worked out that it's approximately 262,000 800 pulses that will give you a 6 month age of the filter. So when the timer here is equal to this number, so if X, which is the total here, remember X is the internal variable for the sensor that it's connected to, so if this sensor age is greater than or equal to the value of timer, we're going to do two things. We're going to turn the onboard LED, we're going to publish that state to true, i.e. turn the LED on, and we're also going to do filter dirty, which is our binary sensor up here, filter dirty there, the ID of that. It's going to turn that on, and as I say, this comes into Home Assistant as studio filter dirty. And then just to finish off, we've got the server component itself. You don't need to worry about anything here. As I say, I've set it all up for you. And then finally, we've got D2, which is on the D1 mini, which is that white wire there. And as you remember, that white wire there went to that R13, which controls the MOSFET, which in turn controls the 24 volts going to the fan. So that gets turned on and off, which is the fan MOSFET, which we'll see here. We turn it on here when the value is 1 or above. Otherwise, we turn it off. This is fan MOSFET here, which is the ID for the switch there. And then also, I'm turning on the switch. When the switch comes on, it turns on the onboard LED. So switch turn on, turn on the onboard LED. And when the switch gets turned off by that code, it turns off the LED. So I hope that makes sense. Like I say, you don't really need to worry about any of this because I've done all the work for you. We just need to install it now. So as this is the first time that I'm using that D1 mini, I'm going to do a manual download. Right, so that's bin file made. Let's go to the desktop and we'll save that there. And we can close that down now. And let's get this flashed. So we're going to plug it in like so. And let's load up ESP Home Flasher. COM3, and we'll browse desktop, studio filter, and we'll flash it. That looks like it's done. It's connected to Wi-Fi, so we can close that down. And if we go back to Home Assistant, we can see we've got a new device. Let's check it out. Here it is, Studio Air Filter. Configure that. Yes. I'm going to put this in the office, and we'll finish. So let's have a scroll down. Let's have a look, see what we're getting back in. We'll just refresh that the first time. So as you can see, we've got Studio Filter Age, which is currently 0 because I haven't run the fan yet. We've got the binary sensor coming in that tells you whether or not the reset button there for the filter age. And we've got the speed, 1 through to 6. And then just so we can see those names, what we need to do is make the browser smaller so those boxes get bigger. I know. And then we can see all the names. Okay, so that looks like it's working. Let's get this apart and put it back in the box. First thing, let's plug in the power supply and the fan, and we'll just line up the control there with its hole and the LED. Washer on, try and get the nut on. Oh, I hate these cheap ass things. Get on there. Just a pair of pliers, doesn't need to be tight, just on there. And I'm gonna line that up. That's that done. A couple of screws in there. And I'm just going to hot glue these into the side of the case. I've already scratched here, like I did with the IKEA sensor. So with some hot glue, I'm going to put a big dollop on the back of the board here. Just hold that on there until it cures. I do. And then the little board, I'm just going to tuck that in underneath there. And I'm going to poke that just in the corner there with some more hot glue. So we'll give that a dollop just to hold that in there. I remember I left the screws in there, so it's going to be quite easy. Just make sure that we're not fouling that hole over there as well. So we'll just place these back in these grooves there, just so it doesn't foul that hole. This one's clear, so we can just slide that back in, get it lined up, push it down, screw it back. Okay, I'm ready to deploy this now. So let's put some filters in, shall we? Now I brought the extra carbon filter as well, just for the hell of it. Goes in there, and then the paper filter goes on top of everything else. And then finally the lids with the tab at the bottom, this one goes apparently. One other thing to note, because we're controlling that MOSFET, remember we put that white wire on, and the so-called PWM signal, so this doesn't do anything anymore. And if we go back to the controls, you can see that if I move this knob, nothing happens, and it only runs when I turn it on. And then in the final code, I'll set that number so you don't have to worry about this demo setting.
Well, I hope this video was helpful for your projects. Please do share it so others can find it as well. I upload videos whenever I can, so subscribe and hit the bell icon to get notified. That's it. Thanks for watching.
Okay, I love you. Bye-bye.